Hey, it's Wong. So I'm going to go over some goniometry measurements, how to use a goniometer here at the clinic. Now, I know that you may have practiced it before you came, but we like to make sure that we're consistent with how we're measuring so that every single time we measure, we're getting the same results and we're consistent in our methods. I like to use a half moon goniometer. We have two of them for the hand, the wrist, and the forearm. This is what I normally use. I have a smaller one here. This can be for the thumb, CMC, or radial and ulnar deviation, CMC, abduction, adduction. I never measure that. Have you ever measured that?
No.
I never measure that. Unless somehow or another you needed it. You can use this to measure the elbow as well, and you can use this to measure forearm. And then this is for elbow and shoulder. All right. So anytime you're measuring with the fingers on this, one of the reasons why I love it so much is because it's really easy to read. All you have to do is place it. So you might have to do a little close up. So when I have someone open their fingers, you're going to measure. How do we write? I'm going to show you how I write it. So it's always X finger extension slash finger flexion, right? So I usually do it on a grid. This is MP, PIP, and DIP. But you can create your own grid, right? Index, so it's a second, third, fourth, and fifth, right? So you can do it like this, or you could do it like, this is your MP, PIP, DIP. And then this is your second, third, fourth, and fifth, right? So however you do your grid, how do you do your grid?
Like that.
Like this one?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think I do it like this too. But you always do the slash, okay? So in front of the slash is your extension, and behind the slash is your flexion. Go ahead and open. If they have zero, if their extension is zero, I don't put a slash. I just go straight into flexion. If they have a contracture here or they can't fully extend, then I'm gonna go ahead and measure. So this is 45, and then I'll put 45 slash, and then flex for me. Pretend like you can't flex. There you go. 85, right? So the 45 is the extension and the 85 is the flexion, right? So when you are asking someone to make a fist, you want to make sure that their wrist is slightly extended, but if they're trying to make a fist and their wrist curls down, you want to give them a little bit of help. Make sure that they keep their wrist slightly extended. So you're going to go in place, and you could do it however you want. So you can do MPs and then IPs, or you can do IPs and MPs. It doesn't matter as long as you remember what you're doing and how you're writing it down, so you can transfer your little notes into your EMR. So we're gonna measure flexion. This is 80. So normally what I do is I remember all four numbers and then I'll write all the MPs down. All right, so you can just put it between your fingers and slide it, so that I'll have one hand here, like this, right? So I'll remember all the numbers, and my hand is just here, so it can help make sure that they're not going into flexion with their wrists, okay? Go ahead and open your fingers, and then curl down around my fingers. So this is how I measure IP. So we're just gonna put the half moon right over the fingers, and then you're gonna get that angle, 110, 100, oh, you almost have like 118 right there, right? So it just sits right over the skin and the knuckle, right? So the reason why you do your IPs this way is so that you can get to your DIP. You can't get to your DIP, right? You can't get to your DIP if your fingers are like this. It's extremely hard to get to your DIP. So that's the reason why I always measure the DIP with a hook fist, okay? Now, if somebody has a certain type of tightness, you can write that too. So if they have IP, but then when they flex, because they have extensor tendon tightness, and they can't flex their IPs when their MPs are down, you just have to notate that. Okay, so every once in a while, there will be people who have that. They can, when they make a fist, their IPs curl and their MPs extend, but then when you have their, if they open up their IPs, their MPs extend, but then they can't fully fist, that's a different type of problem. You just have to notate it. But that's how we measure MP and IP flexion and extension. And I'm gonna use the half moon as well for wrist. So I don't usually measure on the side. You can use this to measure on the side of the fifth. I don't do that. I use my half moon. It's the easiest thing to use, and just make sure that we're consistent each and every single time. Go ahead, and I always measure with the hand up. All right, so you're gonna go into extension, right? And then all you have to do is move that half moon and put it right over the forearm and then the palmar surface, right? Flexion, and then you're gonna put it on the other side. And that's how we measure, flexion and extension. Now, if you have somebody who cannot extend, but they have a natural curvature of like 30 or 40 degrees, but they have actually no wrist extension, you can measure on this side using the curved part of the half moon, and you'd be at like 10 degrees or 0 degrees, but you would have to note 0 degrees dorsal. Or 10 degrees dorsal, because we always measure wrist extension on the volar side, and we always measure wrist flexion on the dorsal side. So if you're changing that, you have to notate it. Otherwise, it's gonna show too big of a discrepancy in our notes, where you don't know if that person is making progress or not making progress, okay? So that's finger, that's wrist, and then the way I measure the thumb is down here. So just move the fingers out of the way, bend your thumb all the way down as much as you can, and then this is gonna sit right over the MP, and then you can do the IP. If they have really great range of motion here and you can't measure their IP, just bring their MPs up. Bend your little knuckle, there you go. And then you can measure that. CMC measurement is usually through opposition. So you can you oppose to the small finger? Yes. Can you bring that thumb all, this is composite, all the way down to the distal palmar crease? Should go to the distal palmar crease. But if you're not really sure, you look at the other uninjured hand to determine what is their normal. That's range of motion of the fingers, the thumb, the wrist, and now supination, pronation. Okay, so go ahead and stand up. I always get patients to stand up for this one because you want their arms to be by their side, okay? And then the half moon will sit. You're gonna turn your palm up as much as you can. The half moon with supination will be on the medial aspect or their ulnar side of the wrist with the stationary arm following the line of the body, and then the movable arm following the forearm, not the wrist, not the hand, the forearm, okay? Because if someone has, like, can twist their hand, but their forearm is not rotated, and you're measuring here, then you're gonna get an inaccurate measurement. Or the next person who measures here, then you're gonna have a huge discrepancy of why were you better, but being in therapy for a month, you're worse, okay? So this is one of the reasons why we measure the same each and every single time, so that we all can be consistent. You're gonna turn your palm down. When they supinate or pronate, you wanna make sure that they're keeping their arm aligned with their body. If they are compensating a lot to make their numbers look better, you've gotta stop them from doing that. So someone who can't supinate is gonna turn their body like this, okay? They're gonna rotate their trunk to make their supination better. Or they're gonna dig their arm into their side and they're gonna turn their arm like that to make it look better. Have them be aligned, symmetric, and then when they pronate, if they can't pronate, their elbow is going to go out like that. So when you measure them and they're compensating, then you're getting an inaccurate measurement as well. So you want to make sure that the elbow's by the side, measure supination on the forearm on the medial aspect. When they go into pronation, then you're going to measure them on the lateral aspect. Still on the ulnar side, but the lateral aspect of the body, okay? So these are really important things to make sure that as therapists within the clinic, that we're consistent with each other and that we're making sure that we're going to show progress each and every single time. So it's goniometry measurements of the fingers, thumb, wrist, and forearm.
Therapy friends, it's Huang here. Thanks again for watching my video. And if you like videos like this that can help you just crush it in the hand therapy world as an occupational therapist, then hit the subscribe button and enjoy the video. Thanks again for watching.